Hallelujah, Christ is risen.
Lord is risen indeed. Hallelujah.
The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Let us pray. O God, whose Son Jesus is the good shepherd of your people, grant that when we hear his voice, we may know him who calls us each by name and follow where he leads, who with you in the Holy Spirit lives and reigns, one God, forever and ever. Amen.
Amen.
Now, in Joppa, there is a disciple whose name was Tabitha, which in Greek is Dorcas. She was devoted to good works and acts of charity. At that time, she became ill and died. When they had washed her, they laid her in a room upstairs. Since Lydda was near Joppa, the disciples who heard that Peter was there sent two men to him with the request, "Please come to us without delay." So Peter got up and went to them. And when he arrived, they took him to the room upstairs. All the widows stood beside him, weeping and showing tunics and other clothing that Dorcas had made while she was with them. Peter put them all outside and then knelt down and prayed. He turned to the body and said, "Tabitha, get up." Then she opened her eyes, and seeing Peter, she sat up. He gave her his hand and helped her up. Then calling the saints and widows, he showed her to be alive. This became known throughout Joppa, and many believed in the Lord. Meanwhile, he stayed in Joppa for some time with a certain Simon, a tanner. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Psalm 23. The Lord is my shepherd. I shall not want. He makes me lie down in green pastures and leads me beside still waters. He revives my soul and guides me along. Shadow of death, I shall fear no evil, for you are with me, your rod and your staff, they comfort me. You spread a table before me John's Revelation. I looked, and there was a great multitude that no one could count. From every nation, from all tribes and peoples and languages, standing before the throne and before the Lamb, robed in white, with palm branches in their hands. They cried out in a loud voice, saying, "Salvation belongs to our God who is seated on the throne and to the Lamb." And all the angels stood around the throne and around the elders and the four living creatures, and they fell on their faces before the throne and worshiped God, singing, "Amen, blessing and glory and wisdom and thanksgiving and honor and power and might be to you, our God, forever and ever. Amen." Then one of the elders addressed me, saying, "Who are these robed in white, and where have they come from?" I said to him, "Sir, you are the one that knows." Then he said to me, "These are they who have come out of the great ordeal and have washed their robes and made them white in the blood of the Lamb. For this reason, they are before the throne of God and worship him day and night within his temple. And the one who is seated on the throne will shelter them. They will hunger no more and thirst no more. The sun will not strike them, nor any scorching heat. For the Lamb at the center of the throne will be their shepherd, and he will guide them to springs of the water of life, and God will wipe away every tear from their eyes." The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Of our Lord Jesus Christ according to John.
Glory to you, Lord Christ.
At that time, the festival of the dedication took place in Jerusalem. It was winter, and Jesus was walking in the temple in the portico of Solomon. So the Jews gathered around him and said to him, "How long will you keep us in suspense? If you are the Messiah, tell us plainly." Jesus answered, "I have told you, and you do not believe. The works that I do in my Father's name testify to me. You do not believe, because you do not belong to my sheep. My sheep hear my voice. I know them, and they follow me. I give them eternal life, and they will never perish. No one will snatch them out of my hand. What my Father has given me is greater than all else, and no one can snatch it out of the Father's hand. The Father and I are one." The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Christ.
I'm sure that many of you have heard the story that decades ago, Louis Armstrong, the great jazz musician, was asked by a journalist, "What is jazz?" And famously, Louis Armstrong responded, "If you gotta ask, you'll never know." We had a friend once who lived with us for several weeks when we were in Iowa City. philosophy professor who was on leave, and he came back to Iowa City and stayed with us. And he spent that summer studying jazz. This was a guy who was not a musician, who couldn't play an instrument, who couldn't even carry a tune, but he wanted to learn what jazz was. So he got some, I don't know, Columbia Records, or somebody put out this like 14 album, you know, compendium of jazz, and he sat there with a guidebook and he read about jazz and he listened to jazz, and by the end of the summer, he didn't know nothing about jazz. If you gotta ask, you'll never know. Sort of a little bit like an encounter that I've had with a particular person when I said, you know, honey, what's wrong? And that person said, if you have to ask, I'm not gonna tell you. That comes to mind today just because of the encounter that we've just heard about in the gospel. Jesus, maybe halfway through his ministry, is standing in the portico of Solomon on the east side of the great temple in Jerusalem. Now, portico of Solomon was the only one protected from the winter wind that was coming from the west. This is December. It is the Feast of Dedication, which we now know as Hanukkah. And Jesus is gathered there in the portico, the very same place in which the kings of Israel used to proclaim laws and used to promulgate justice. He's standing there, gathered around him are people, a variety of people. We don't know if they were just scribes and Pharisees, or if there were people more perhaps affectionately turned to him, but whatever the case, there is a crowd around him, and they finally say, okay, enough with the metaphors, enough with the parables, enough with the images. Tell us plainly, are you the Messiah? Are you the one we have been waiting for? And I imagine that it may have run through Jesus' mind something like Louis Armstrong's response, if you gotta ask, you'll never know. Because by this point in Jesus' ministry, in John's gospel, he has already turned water into wine at the wedding in Cana. He has already walked across the Sea of Galilee. He has already fed 5,000 people with a few loaves and a couple of fish. He's already healed a man who was lame for 38 years and restored sight to a man who was born blind. He has worked wonders and marvels. He has manifested the holy reign of God in his actions as well as his words. And so Jesus says, ultimately in response, the actions speak for themselves. If you believe the actions, then you know who I am. If you don't believe the actions, nothing I'm going to say is going to change your mind. And what would have happened if Jesus had said clearly, yes, yes, cut to the chase, I am the Messiah? Then he would have given his enemies all sorts of ammunition to charge with blasphemy, to lead him immediately before the high council to charge him with heresy. Of course, that did happen. But if he had said, no, I am not, then the leaders and the authorities could have dismissed him out of hand, and those who had followed him, those who had been drawn to him because of the wonder of his words as well as the majesty of his signs, would have begun to stray as well. So Jesus does not, in fact, answer the question. This is something he does repeatedly, if you've noticed. When asked the direct question, is it lawful to pay tribute to Caesar or not, he always goes in the left, the side door, and he does so today as well. He says that he is the shepherd and the sheep know his voice. Now this is the fourth Sunday of the Easter season, and every year on the fourth Sunday we celebrate Good Shepherd Sunday. The gospel for this day is always taken from this chapter in John's gospel. And today we hear once again Jesus liken himself to the shepherd, to the good shepherd, to the one whose voice the sheep know. Now, Jesus used a lot of metaphors to describe himself. The door, the gate, the way, the truth, the life, the resurrection and the life, the vine, the branches, all sorts of imagery to describe who he was and what his mission was about. But none truly was as beloved or has remained as beloved as this image of Jesus as the shepherd. And I think partly because it resonated so deeply with the people of the ancient world. I mean, think of all the ways in which shepherds played a prominent role in the history of Israel. Abel was a shepherd before he was slain by his brother Cain out of anger and envy. Jacob followed the flock of his anointed the king of Israel. Again and again, this imagery of the shepherd guiding the flock resonated throughout the ancient world. I don't know about you, but it's been a while since I saw a shepherd walking down Green Bay Road. So maybe it doesn't speak to us quite as clearly or powerfully as it did 2,000 years ago, and yet it is still a beloved image. What psalm do we know as well as the one we just read, Psalm 23? What psalm is used at as many funerals? The imagery we see often of Jesus carrying a lamb on his shoulders, it still somehow resonates with us. Jesus as the shepherd. Now it is at this point that every preacher has to say, but we don't really want to be likened to sheep, do we? Because sheep, as we have been told, are stupid. They're dumb. They, if you've ever been, say, in Great Britain, driven in the Highlands of Scotland or in Yorkshire, whatever, I mean, sheep will literally just lie in the middle of the road. They can drown in just a few inches of water. They don't know how to do anything on their own. Sheep, we have been told, are dumb, and therefore to be likened to sheep is something we might find insulting. I was intrigued to learn some time ago that, in fact, part of the bad rap that sheep get comes from cattle ranchers. That 100 more years ago, they began to put out this word that sheep were dumb because they didn't behave like cattle. I mean, you know, if you want to get cattle movies from behind them, you fire off guns, you yell, you crack a whip, and they'll go forward. If you do that to sheep, they'll run behind you. Cattle like to be driven, sheep like to be led. And cattle ranchers didn't understand that, and so they said the sheep were dumb. Whatever the point, whether they're stupid or not, we don't want to be sheep, do we? But the point is not about the sheep. The point of the metaphor is about the shepherd. The shepherd who calls us by name. The shepherd whose voice we recognize. The shepherd who in times of joy or sorrow, in times of celebration or fear, is there with us. The shepherd who, even when we don't believe in him, believes in us. I mentioned how beloved the Psalm, the 23rd Psalm is, but have you read it carefully lately? Yes, it talks about being led by paths of righteousness and being taken to the waters and by being put out in pasture and fertile fields, but it also says, the shepherd will be with me even when I walk through the valley of the shadow of death. It talks about the shepherd preparing a table in the face of my enemies. It isn't all just beauty and peace and bucolic serenity. The psalm reminds us that the shepherd is there in times fearful and joyous, in times dark and light. It isn't about the sheep. It's about the shepherd. If you're like me also, you want a clear answer. You want Jesus to say, yes. How many times in my life, how many times this week have I wanted a clear sign? In this dark and daunting world, with the tragedies that swirl around us, with the challenges that we may face in our own lives, how many times do we want God just to write in the clouds, yes, I exist, or to hear that voice to say, I am he? We all probably have wanted that, have longed for that. Why, O God, do you awaken in me longings and hungers that you do not then satisfy immediately? Why, O God, do you awaken in me a desire for clarity and then refuse to give me that clarity? But that's not the way God works, is it? God instead calls us. God summons us. God beckons us. God calls us by name to this place, to this day, to this time, to this life. On this overcast Sunday morning in May, here we are. Because our names have been called, because we know the voice of the one who calls us, it isn't about us. It is about the one who gathers us, who promises to protect us, even in the darkness or the gray or the ambiguity or the challenges of life. The one who promises, yes, to feed us and to nurture us and lead us to pastures green and verdant. It isn't about us. It's about him. not clean-cut answers, but a way into a deeper reality. And also, I might add, who calls us together. Shepherds didn't watch just one sheep. They were in relationship with an entire sheepfold. So we find who we are and to whom we belong together. When we gather on Sundays, when we gather in any other setting, at any other time, we are reminded that we belong to a body greater and larger than ourselves. So this metaphor, this image, where Jesus likens himself to the shepherd, is not one meant to make us regret that we are sheep, but instead to rejoice that there is a shepherd. A shepherd who is with us even when we walk through the valley of the shadow of death. A shepherd who prepares a table before us even in the presence of our enemies. The shepherd who is present with that seventh grader afraid to go to school out of fear of being bullied. With that mid-career person anxious that she's going to lose her job. With that person who has seen a death in the family or who has seen the breakup of a relationship. With the retired person not sure what to do with himself. The shepherd walks with all of us, in times joyful and fearful, celebratory and solemn. It isn't about us, my woolly friends. It's about the shepherd who has called us, who has named us, who has summoned us, who will protect us, who will guide us, who will feed us, who loves us. Who loves us.
We believe in one God.
Alleluia. Our glorious God has raised Jesus from death to life. Let every heart be filled with praise. Alleluia. Sanctify your creation as abundant new life now bursts forth.
Let all share the wholeness promised to our broken world.
Guide those in authority to transcend the barriers that separate the human family and work together for peace. We pray especially for an end to all war, terror, and violence in every heart and land. Encourage your church to celebrate the resurrection with joy, committing ourselves to work of reconciliation.
That Christ's body may be one.
Empower your ministers to proclaim boldly the message of the resurrection.
That all may come to see you as our first Lord.
Inspire us to live faithfully our baptismal vows and to partake lovingly of the sacred bread and wine. Assist those who suffer or are in need, the poor, the lonely, the homeless, the disabled. Embrace those who have died with your eternal love. Hear our special intercessions for this day, O Lord, as we pray for those on our prayer list, remembering those from our parish, including Mary, Elizabeth, Clara, Jean, Margaret. We pray for Cameron, Casey, Christopher, and Robin. We pray for John, Dylan, Anne, Arden, for Sam, Laura, Luann, Julia. We pray also for Dawn, Nancy, Barb, Gwen, Marty. We pray for Cindy, Frank, Marilyn, Andrew, John, Carol, and Louise. Also, we remember Betsy, Megan, Jill, Jim, Dan, Anne, Lisa. Also, Donna, Barbara, David, Susie, Peta, Lenore, Amanda, Kirsten, and Tom. We give thanks for the many blessings of this life, remembering those who have birthdays today. Nicholas Bungie, Sophia Civetta, and Ginny Hilton, and for those celebrating a wedding anniversary, Buddy and Jan Baker, especially for all mothers on this Mother's Day celebration, and for other blessings. We pray for those who have died, especially John Phillips, who died this past week, and for Eleanor Allison Irvin and Helen Rugg Condit, for whom the altar flowers have been given. We also pray for Kumalai, one of the outreach ministries this parish supports.
Almighty and everlasting God, who in the Paschal mystery has established the new covenant of reconciliation, grant that all who have been reborn into the fellowship of Christ's body may show forth in their lives what they profess by their faith, through Jesus Christ our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever. Amen. Amen. The peace of the Lord be always with you.
And also with you. Tonight,
The last gathering will take place of the mom's Bible study talking about the miracles of Jesus. Most of you know that this is going on the last few weeks as Pastor Heath has facilitated a conversation for moms and grandmas to learn how to talk about the miracles of Jesus, not only for themselves, but also for children and grandchildren. Even if you haven't been to previous sessions tonight, please consider joining at 7 o'clock down in the great, the library. And that will also be the site Wednesday. I don't know why I'm getting my times and dates wrong. On Wednesday, the Wednesday morning class will continue at 9:45 on the Passion of Jesus according to the Gospel of Mark. This is an extension, if you will, of the adult class earlier this late winter and early spring. Open to all, 9:45 in the library. Might mention as well, this is a new notice, that this Tuesday night, on the 14th, the Stephen Ministry is going to be hosting David Carlson, the executive director of the Samaritan Counseling Center in Winnetka. Many of you will remember when David was with us a couple of months ago in the adult forum to talk about gratitude. This time we'll be talking about hope and joy. And the gathering is open to all people, not just Stephen Ministry. They'd like to welcome anybody who wants to come hear David Carlson speak 7 o'clock Tuesday night in the library. If you do hope to come, I hope you will let us know in the office just so we know how to set up the room. Also wanted to extend our sorrow to Mary Phillips. As I think most or all of you saw in the e-blast that went out on Friday, John, her husband, died on Thursday in Mexico. FJ and his sister Dory are already in Mexico. They are taking care of affairs. We will let the parish know when John's funeral will take place and interment here in the Columbarium. John was a lifelong member of Holy Comforter. He sang in the choir for years along with Mary. He was part of the men's gathering on Saturday mornings. He stirred up a lot of trouble in a loving, fun way. And a wonderful, eccentric, complicated guy, shall we say. So, deeply missed. So please keep your eyes open for when we will celebrate John's life. In the meanwhile, to Mary, to FJ and Carrie, their children, our hearts and our love. And finally, wanted to give thanks today for all mothers, for all who have offered the gift of life to all of us. So to all of the mothers present, to the grandmothers present, to all of us who have beloved memories of or still beloved experiences or relationships with our mothers, thank you on this blessed day. As I mentioned, the 8 o'clock, of course, one of the prominent figures in the New Testament is Mary, who was the one who gave birth to the God-bearer, the Theotokos, the one who made possible the Incarnation, and of course, therefore, is revered throughout the Christian world. And today, we give thanks for all mothers who have been bearers of us and brought life into the world. So thank you, and God bless you on this lovely day. Walk in love, as Christ loved us and gave himself for us, an offering and sacrifice to God.
Thank you. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give God thanks and praise.
It is right and a good and joyful thing, always and everywhere to give thanks to you, Father Almighty, Creator of heaven and earth. But chiefly are we bound to praise you for the glorious resurrection of your Son, Jesus Christ our Lord. For he is the true Paschal Lamb who was sacrificed for us and has taken away the sin of the world. By his death he has destroyed death, and by his rising to life again, he has won for us everlasting life. Therefore we praise you, joining our voices with angels and archangels, and with all the company of heaven, who forever sing this hymn to proclaim the glory of your name.
Holy and gracious Father, in your infinite love, you made us for yourself. And when we had fallen into sin and become subject to evil and death, you in your mercy sent Jesus Christ, your only and eternal Son, to share our human nature, to live and die as one of us, to reconcile us to you, the God and Father of all. He stretched out his arms upon the cross and offered himself in obedience to your will, a perfect sacrifice for the whole world. On the night he was handed over to suffering and death, our Lord Jesus Christ took bread. And when he had given thanks to you, he broke it, gave it to his disciples, and said, "Take, eat, this is my body which is given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." After supper, he took the cup of wine. And when he had given thanks, he gave it to them and said, "Drink this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Whenever you drink it, do this for the remembrance of me." Therefore, we proclaim the mystery of faith. Christ has died.
Christ is risen.
Christ will come again. We celebrate the memorial of our redemption, O Father, in this sacrifice of praise and thanksgiving, recalling his death, resurrection, and ascension. We offer you these gifts. Sanctify them by your Holy Spirit to be for your people the body and blood of your Son, the holy food and drink of new and unending life in him. Sanctify us also, that we may faithfully receive this holy sacrament and serve you in unity, constancy, and peace. And at the last day, bring us with all your saints into the joy of your eternal kingdom. All this we ask through your Son, Jesus Christ, by him and with him and in him. In the unity of the Holy Spirit, all honor and glory is yours, Almighty Father, now and forever. Amen. Now, as our Savior Christ has taught us, we are bold to say, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed
be thy name.
Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we
forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation,
but deliver us from evil. Gifts of God for the people of God. Let us pray. Eternal God, Heavenly Father, you have graciously accepted us as living members of your Son, our Savior, Jesus Christ, and you have fed us with spiritual food in the sacrament of his body and blood. Send us now into the world in peace, and grant us strength and courage to love and serve you with gladness and singleness of heart, through Christ our Lord. Amen. The God of peace, who brought again from the dead our Lord Jesus Christ, the great shepherd of the sheep, through the blood of the everlasting covenant, make you perfect in every good work to do his will, working in you that which is well-pleasing in his sight. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be among you and remain with you always. Amen. Amen.
Hallelujah.
Thanks be God.